Good morning, everyone. I'm Pastor Dustin Abbott from Emmanuel Lighthouse United Pentecostal Church here in Petawawa, Ontario, Canada. I'm here for your Tuesday morning devotion. I was actually spending some of my own time in devotion and study and prayer this morning, and I tend to read through study Bibles every year in their entirety because I just enjoy the insights from various authors, and I don't obviously always agree with everything that is said, as you're about to see, but it does kind of stimulate my mind, give me some food for thought, and has been a part of my process for a while. So anyway, I was reading as a part of my Bible reading today, part of Acts chapter 19. And there's a passage there that talks about the miraculous that was taking place and juxtaposes what was happening in the life of the Apostle Paul with some who were just imitators. And so let's take a look in the middle of the chapter at verse 13. It says, "Then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists took it upon themselves to call the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, 'We exorcise you by the Jesus whom Paul preaches.' Also there were seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, who did so. And the evil priest answered and said, 'Jesus I know, and Paul I know, but who are you?' Then the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped on them, overpowered them, and prevailed against them, so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded." Those that are a part of Emmanuel Lighthouse, the church that I pastor, know that this is a passage that I love to allude to. There's something about the irony of the whole situation that is comical on one hand, but also has an incredibly important message on another hand, which we'll get to in just a second. But I was frankly shocked to read the comment that followed this passage in my study Bible, and I'm not going to mention today who the author of the study Bible is. I have a great deal of respect for some of their insights and positions on other things, and so I'm certainly not here to denigrate or tear them down. Suffice it to say, I completely disagree with the statement that I'm about to read. It reads, "Recognizing that the exorcist had no authority over him, unlike Jesus and Paul, the demon rejected their attempt to expel him from his victim. This confirms," and this is where I have a problem, "that the power to cast out demons belonged to Jesus and the apostles and no one else. Even the demons give testimony to that." I've noticed a trend from this writer in the book of Acts and other passages where he seems to believe that there were certain divine privileges that were assigned to the apostles, the 12, and then by addition, Paul, that were given to no one else. And very clearly, he's making a statement here that the power to cast out demons belongs solely to Jesus and the apostles and to no one else. That statement kind of blew my mind in the sense that if we today as believers have no authority to cast out demons, who exactly then will cast out demons from the demon possessed? Very clearly, Jesus and the apostles are not here in the flesh to do that. And so it seems to me that his belief system leaves those who are demon possessed, even demon oppressed, in an impossible situation. Very clearly, I think we can agree today that this is not what the message that is being taught here in Scripture. In fact, I mean, my mind immediately flashed to a very important statement by Jesus as a part of Mark's rendition of the Great Commission. This is Mark chapter 16, verses 17 and 18. It says, "And these signs shall follow those who believe. In my name they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover." So Jesus says, these signs shall follow them that believe. So believers, he didn't talk about the apostles or some specially appointed group, but he said of believers that the first thing that he says, in my name they will cast out demons. So there's a couple of things there, that one of which we'll circle back to in just a moment. But he's making the clear statement that believers will have the authority through his name to cast out demons. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 4, it says, "You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world." Again, this is speaking about spiritual authority and how that those who have the Holy Spirit in them, that's the he that is alluded to here. If the Holy Spirit indwells you as a believer, then you have an authority and a power greater than any spiritual force that is in the world. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 27 says, "Nor give place to the devil." And so it's clear that we don't have to make room for the devil, that we don't have to give a place to him. And so if the intent here in this passage is not to say that only a select group of appointed individuals have the authority to cast out demons, and so these itinerant exorcists, nor the seven sons of Sceva, they were not on the approved list, and thus they had no authority. I don't believe at all that's what's being taught in Scripture, nor do I believe that that's why this illustration is included in Scripture. I believe that there's a much more important lesson that is being taught there, and something that we can actually learn from here today. So first of all, I believe that the key to all of this is found in James chapter 4 and verse 7. It says, "Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you." One of the, I think, most important passages from the Gospels that on the subject of spiritual authority comes from an account of a Roman centurion that came to Jesus asking him to heal his servant that was at home. So Jesus agrees that he would come, and the centurion says, "Lord, you don't need to come to my house." He says, "All you need to do is speak the word and my servant will be healed." And he illustrated why he believed that by going on to talk about that he himself was a man that was under authority. And the ironic thing, though, is that he illustrated what being authority was like by talking about using authority. He talked about those that were under his command and how he told them to go there, and they went to do this, and they did. But Jesus was astounded and responded very positively to the faith of this man. But in this is a really, really important principle, and that is that this man, as a military officer, he understood the command structure. He says, "I understand how authority works because I am a man under authority." And then he talked about telling people to do things, and they did it. But the point that he was making is that the reason why men under his command obeyed his word is because he was a part of a command structure, that he was a man under authority. And so he was working within a framework that, you know, stretched all the way back to the Emperor of Rome, to the authority of the state of Rome. And so because he was a part of that command structure, he was under authority, he was submitted to a higher authority, it gave him then, by extension, the authority to command others to do his bidding. And so in like fashion, if a military officer steps out of the command structure, they retire, they become a civilian, they don't have to take orders anymore. But they also don't get to give orders anymore. You see, that's how authority works. It works through a command structure. And so James says that if you're submitted to God, you're under his authority, then you have authority over the devil, because you're no longer facing him under your own authority, but you are commanding him under God's authority. So let's go back then to our original passage with that understanding in mind. Because here is what I believe the real lesson in Scripture is being taught. And that lesson is this: these itinerant Jewish exorcists and also these seven sons of Sceva that are mentioned here, these were those that heard what Paul was doing, heard that Paul was using the authority of the name of Jesus, which is just what Jesus says. Jesus says, "In my name, believers will cast out demons." So they, hearing that Paul was using the authority of the name of Jesus to cast out demons, they just took it, you know, one step further in the, you know, and they just said, "I adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaches." It's like, well, if one name is good, dropping two names is better. But the demon looked back at them and says, "Paul I know, and Jesus I know, I know both of those individuals, but who are you? And instead of being cast out, the demon attacked one man, demon-possessed, attacked these seven and drove them out, tore their clothes off, and sent them into the street naked and bleeding in complete embarrassment over their failed exorcism attempt. So the point here was is the demon was recognizing the authority structure that flows through relationship. So these men, they were not really in under authority to Jesus Christ. They were not in relationship with Jesus Christ. They had not submitted their lives to Jesus Christ. They were just name dropping, trying to use some magical incantation, some formula that dropped the names. But the demon says, it's not so much the name that I recognize. I do recognize those names, but that gives you no authority over me. Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. You, I don't. And you have no authority over me. You see, they were trying to drop the names, but use their own authority. And there was no power. There was no authority that was there. Because authority flows through relationship. It's all about relationship. And that's what's really being taught here. The reason why Paul had authority to cast out demons in the name of Jesus is because he was submitted to Jesus Christ. He was in relationship with him. He was in the command structure that flows with the authority of the name of Jesus. These seven sons of Sceva or these other exorcists, they were not in relationship. They were not under authority. Thus, they had no authority. So there's the lesson for us. If we want to have spiritual authority in our lives, we have to be under authority ourselves. It's extraordinary today how many people seem to think that they can go without having a pastor in their lives. They can go without being submitted to spiritual authority. They can go without really having a relationship with Jesus Christ. And then they want all of the perks and benefits that come from those things, you know, come from having a pastor in their lives or, you know, and so whenever they have a need, they want to feel like they can call upon the pastor to serve their interest, but they don't want to be submitted to his authority at any other time. You know, they want to call on Jesus like a vending machine, but they don't want to put in the work of having a relationship with him or being submitted to him in their lives. And then they wonder why they have no power and they have no authority. And it's because of this. Authority flows through command structure. If you're not in the command structure to where you're willing to take orders, you have no authority to give orders by extension. And so that is why it is so imperative that we understand both halves of what James says. James says, submit yourselves therefore unto God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. If you're not submitted unto God, you can resist the devil all day long. He won't flee from you. Because he doesn't recognize your authority, but he does recognize when you're under authority and can use the authority of the name of Jesus. Submission is the key to power in a relationship with God. When Paul said in Philippians 2, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, he talked about Jesus' greatest triumph that would culminate in every knee bowing and every tongue confessing that he is Lord of all. But the path to that point, he talks about submission, that Jesus humbled himself, that he submitted himself, that he took on the form of a man, that he was not grasping at equality, but rather he was willing to be humbled, to fall into the right place in the command structure in order to achieve the end of Calvary and its victory. And that's the mindset that Paul says needs to be in us, that we need to be willing to be submitted. And when we do so, we unlock great power in our lives. I pray that this has given you some inspiration today, has helped you to understand some things more deeply when it comes to spiritual authority, spiritual warfare. Put it into practice. God bless you. Have a blessed, wonderful day.